Welcome back to Afternoon Express. Now, Muthori Neshehe has captured women's hearts with his heartthrob role status as Ndalomo on SABC 2's Muvango.
Now, this seasoned actor has spread his wings to the behind the scenes of the industry and is making his mark where it really matters. Now, connect with us online if you've got any questions for Muthori, and please tweet us at Afternoon Chat using the official hashtag Afternoon Express or comment on our Facebook page. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thank you.
Lovely to see you again. I'm finally here.
Yes.
This couch is more comfortable than I thought it was.
But now, I haven't seen you in a while, and now I gave you a hug earlier, and you're feeling ripped. Have you been working out?
You know, you're not going to believe me, but I haven't been to the gym in... I went once in November and once in December.
No ways. Wow.
So, but during the year, religiously.
Yeah, no,
I eat right, and I just go and just...
So strong. You know. Heaven sent.
Yeah. Thank you.
You know, it's that consistency, I think, that you've shown working out in the gym that we see being exactly mirrored in your career. You're just consistent from strength to strength, soapy to soapy movies. I mean, across the board, you are a stand-up sterling act. How has the journey been like looking back at the years? And do you kind of pinch yourself to be like, hey, man, I did that?
I don't really... I look at my job as a job just like anybody else, you know? I go to work, then I go home. But obviously, I set my goals a little bit further than most people, and sometimes I will stop and, you know, regroup and figure out what it is that I want to do. But what I like to do is I like to get new challenges in my life. Every time you do something, you know, I got to be the better person than I was, simple as yesterday. Wake up the better man than I was yesterday. And after a year or so, you are far beyond what you thought you could be. Yeah. But because it's baby steps, you know.
Compound interest.
Exactly.
That you keep adding.
The one that the banks hit us with.
Yeah.
But you are just so good at that. Like, you've had an extraordinary career. You've got movie star good looks. And also, you've also gone behind the scenes now. Yes. I mean, your production company is doing really exciting work. Tell us a little bit about some of the work that you've been doing.
I've been doing documentaries. I was in Venda this December working on a documentary. Yeah. And I need to go back and finish it. But it's a 10-year documentary that I've been working on.
Wow.
So I shot it in 2009 and I revisited it in 2019. So I'm going to go do the interviews next month.
Documentaries always fascinate me because it always seems like so much work. Mm.
It is a lot of work, and it's also patience.
I mean,
anything that we do around here is patience and repetition, you know, unless you're live.
Yeah.
Then you don't have the luxury of repetition.
You'll be shook real quick.
Exactly. You just need to be a little crazy.
But you just have to, you know, just keep pushing and be patient and just do... Step by step.
But do you find the kind of work that you choose in documentaries, is a little bit more passionate?
It has to be passionate because then you focus on it. Then you try to get the truth and then maybe even give answers to the people who are living that life, you know?
Yeah.
For me, it's, well, the passion is the least of it, but also the art.
Yeah.
Of making a good documentary that the world will be willing to see. I had a friend of mine ask me, like, so what makes you think people want to see this documentary? I'm like,
well, what's it about?
it's about the bare fist knuckle fighting in Venda.
Oh,
wow.
Yeah, so I
can't wait to watch this.
I did it in 2009, and then I came back, and it has grown to just being in a crawl, to now being in a stadium.
Yeah.
So I went there and I met with the chief, and he gave me his blessing. I met with the guys who organized it, and it was...
You didn't get into the ring, hey?
I was challenged in 2009, and I thought to myself, I'm gonna get in.
Yeah.
Because this scrawny little guy
would...
But then I'm like, this guy can put me to sleep. It takes one good punch to put anybody to sleep. So I'm like, nah, it's good. I make some money with this.
Don't affect the money maker.
And I was going to say, all of the ladies watching do not want you to be touched. So
no one
come after us. You have been warned. But what is it about that magic and that kind of drive working behind the scenes? Because I can only imagine how different it is being in front of camera and behind.
It's passion. I mean, like, I've always said, okay, I'm gonna stop acting and focus on the behind the scene, but the acting also always pulls me back.
Yeah.
A good project comes up, you know? But the passion is actually from the patience of the guys behind the scene.
Mm.
So if you have the discipline and the patience to sit with a script for 5, 8, 10 years until the time comes, you have to have that passion to actually maintain and just to own creativity, you know? I mean, as an actor, I only own what it is that I perform, and I can own that character, that moment.
Yeah.
But as a producer, as a director, the whole project is a lot of work. You know, it's you're dealing with personalities.
Yeah.
You know, you're dealing with 50, 60 people, excluding the actors.
And those everyone are the drama is looking queens, at you.
I know
you
because I was one.
And you've also done such an incredible job at keeping your professional life very professional and above board and not letting that private life kind of sink into the news and have everybody gossiping and talking about it. And you've got incredible kids who are your inspiration. I mean, how has that juggling act been for you, and how have you been able to keep the two quite separate?
Like I said, it's just as simple as keeping my work, and I always explain it to people, like, what I do for a living, I'm just like the guy who works at Pick It Up or Checkers or anywhere. I do my work, I'm not a celebrity at home.
Yeah.
The kids are like,
Daddy.
So you're on TV, what? You know? I'm like, but no, you don't get it. Guess who I was working with today? They're like,
and
I'm hungry.
Your point, you're blocking the TV.
What do you think has been the greatest lesson that fatherhood has taught you?
Fatherhood has taught me patience.
Yeah.
You know, I always tell people that, you know, it's amazing how you can be all of this, but then when you come home, they just love you. Yeah. For just being there, just appearing.
Yeah, they don't care you worked with that dad, you know? Until you tell them it was with Pally and GDD, then
they're like, can I come next time? That is so beautiful, though, and I think it's that family man spirit that you just kind of exude without even trying. What has been some of the most eye-opening, scary moments that you kind of were shook from the core, and you want to show your kids that, hey, look, I was brave in that moment, I was courageous, I pushed through, whether it's in the industry, working for so many years, or drama queens like us?
No, I think the thing that actually motivates me to teach my kids is just for them to be themselves. The world is going to test you. You know, I mean, as simple as life. Life is simple. People complicate it. Relationships are simple. People complicate them. You know, but now when you let outside influence come in and tell me how I should raise my kids, I honestly don't do much except for be there. You know, when I take trips and I work out of town, I take them with me. You know?
Do you really?
Yeah, I used to turn down jobs if they were not going to accommodate my family. But, you know, now they have their own schedules. They have their own routine. You know, I come home and they're like, oh, he's back.
He's here again.
But don't you think having that balance is, like, I suppose there's studies around the fact that when you're happy at home and that when you've got that purpose with children, then you actually do better in your careers.
That's true. That's true. I mean, if you know what your purpose is, my purpose is to create the best human beings. Mm. That's the only job I have as a man.
Yeah.
Everything else, you can replace me or not. Another guy could be sitting here right now, you know? But that job is my job.
There's very few men who could replace you, my
darling. We wouldn't want them to either.
But you seem so connected and so present and so, like aware. Do you do any kind of work on yourself, like, spiritually?
I do meditate. Yeah. I do sit. The best thing that I do is I take my boat out to the water and I just sit.
Must be nice.
Listen, if I had a boat, I'd also be super happy.
Must be so nice. I just take my boat out and okay.
You know what I used to
do? All about this yacht life.
What I used to do is I used to drop the kids off at school, go to Hartebees, hang out in the boat all day, and then go pick him up. But I wouldn't tell him that that's where I was because they would hate me for that because they love being in the water too.
Yeah.
But then I would come home and I'd be at peace, you know? I'd be centered, nothing would bother me, you know? And that's, you gotta find your own thing. I like to be outside, pretty much.
And the fact that you've got that center and you found your peace has given you so much purpose beyond just yourself and your life and your family. You've got a foundation, tell us a little bit about
that. Yes, I got the Mutodina Shehe Foundation, and I wanna focus on, and I just started recently, I wanna focus on the poor communities, the informal settlements where, so we live in multi-million rent houses, and right there next to us is people who don't have.
I know.
And I mean, I know in my house, I got a ton of kids' clothes. That's a ton of kids without clothes, not even 3 kilometers away from me. So what I'm doing is I'm collecting all these things. I'm gonna try and figure out if I can partner up with somebody for packaging purposes or logistic purposes. So I'm not just focusing on the areas where I live.
Yeah.
And that's what the most important thing is the kids, but I also have clothes. I mean, I have a ton of clothes. I got clothes I've never worn. I got a closet.
There's much stuff that can be made available to other people in need.
Exactly, exactly.
Absolutely.
So what happened is that a couple of years ago, they moved an informal settlement from where, next to where I used to live. They moved them somewhere else, and a few months later, a little baby girl died from being cold.
No.
And I've been carrying that with me for like a few years until I said, you know, I've been talking about the foundation for a few years now. I finally said, I'm just going to do it.
Yeah.
You know, and I just went out and registered it, and everything is going smooth right now.
So many changes like that need to be happening. Like in South Africa, children are dying from stuff as simple as diarrhea, which can be fixed. It can be helped. Thank you so much for all the amazing work that you're doing.
Thank you
for just being you. You are an absolute light. So we're so happy to have you here today.
A role model, not only at home, but in front of our screens daily. We appreciate you. Now, joining us after the break is budding rap star Crazy J Suave, and he's performing live in studio.